KSM Show.
Welcome to the KSM Show, and today on this show, we are hanging out with the BBC, man. BBC! Oh my goodness. Hey, times have changed. When we're kids, it was only the BBC and Radio Ghana. No other place to go, but you go to BBC. I remember even in 1966, so all of you were not born, most of you. Huh? We were suspecting something was going wrong in the country because it was only martial music. Then somebody said, listen to BBC. So we went to BBC to find out there has been a coup in Ghana. Show some love, man. There's a coup in Ghana, and we tuned into BBC to find out more about the coup, man. But today, you know, we have our own radio stations, man. FM, show some love for FM, man. Anyway, the thing about the British people is that even Ghanaians who stayed in Britain, or they live in Britain, when they come back, they're very different, man. Returnees from the UK are different. Show some love for the returnees from the UK, man. I'm saying this because I know. My own sister, I'm sure you know Nima. Put your hands together for Nima, man. And Nima and I, we went to our village in Abomosu. And you know the tradition. When you go to the house, they bring you water. So when we went to Abomosu, they brought us some water, you know, and we were drinking, and Nima was sitting down. I said, Nima, this is a tradition. Drink some water. Don't they have tea? Oh! Pretty for Mukuye. You want tea in Abomosu? When you have his diet, show some love. But let me tell you the best part, man. They were driving around town. You know, this is Anima and my cousin. And then Anima is driving, and the police stopped them. And I think there was something wrong with their... Something! So the police is interrogating them, you know, and for all intents and purposes, when the police interrogate you for more than 5 minutes, you know that it's not about the interrogation, man. It's about... It's all about some local fuel! So my cousin sitting beside Nima was hinting her, swore, you know, undertones. Give him something. And Nima turned to look at policeman and said, oh, why, sir? Do you want a bribe? Oh! You should have seen the policeman's face. He was in shock. I said, oh, madam, why? You can't say that. You are not from around here, are you? Show some love, man. Only a Ghanaian sitting in the BBC will look at the policeman and ask him, why, sir, do you want a bribe? What's he be that? Anyway, we have a great show for you today. The BBC in the house. Well, we have Mr. Peter Horrocks, who's the head of the BBC World Service. He's in the house, and joins the love, man. Not only that, we have two Ghanaians, two of our favorites, Vera Kwakofi. Put your hands together for her. Vera Kwakofi, she's the editor for Current Affairs, African Program. She's in the house. And so is Akosi Sabon, who's the presenter of Focus on Africa. Today, they're all here. All right. And also don't forget that the Business and Financial Times, BFT, is now our business partner. And if you want to get any information ahead of time in terms of who's on the KSM show, get the BFT edition every Friday morning. All right? Now, shall we start the show? Yeah. Shall we start the show? Yeah. All right, put your hands together, let's say the KSM show!
KSM Show.
Well, welcome to the KSM Show. No, I told you in the opening, today is just us and the BBC, man. We're hanging out with the BBC, man. And coming up much later, my two children, man. Yeah, my two children. Akwesi Sapong, you know him, so love, man. He's my son. Also, Vera Kwakufi in the house, so love, man. And when they, thank you. When they come on, you know why they are my children. But in the meantime, before they come on, I'm going to introduce this gentleman. Believe it or not, he entered BBC as a news trainee in 1981. And he's worked through the ranks, and believe it or not, he's now the director of the World Service of BBC. Put your hands together. Welcome, Peter Howard. Show some love, man. Show some love. Peter, welcome to the show.
Thank you. It's like a great show. I'm enjoying it already.
Oh, I love it. Show some love, man. He's enjoying it. Well, good to have you in Ghana. Your first time?
It is my first time, yes.
Yeah. Unfortunately, I know it was a tragic event that brought you down here.
Yes.
Well, folks, I'm sure you are aware that Comrade Moore passed and he worked for the BBC. Just a brief comment on...
Well, Comrade was just a fantastic guy. He was a real friend. He was a brilliant broadcaster. Of course, he did great journalism. Comrade never believed in being too serious about things when it was things to enjoy. So it's fine to... talk and have fun, even though brought me here is a very sad event.
Yeah. You're right, man. There was always that touch of lightness, no matter how heavy he was.
Exactly. He had a great gift for getting people to talk because he had such a vibrant personality. He really knew how to talk to anyone at whatever level. Mm-hmm. So, you know, he could talk to presidents and prime ministers. He could talk to someone, you know, pushing a wheelbarrow along in the street and had that ability to connect with them. And that's what made his journalism so great, because journalism is about human communication, and Comrade was a brilliant communicator and a fantastic son of Ghana and a great representative of the country.
Well, let's do it. and quickly, thank you. Before we move on, what was your immediate reaction when the news hit you?
I was just devastated. I couldn't believe it. I mean, none of us could, because Comrade was just such a lively, vibrant person, and it was just impossible to imagine that someone with such life in him had gone so suddenly and so early. It was awful. I've spent a lot of time with his widow and his children and his family, and of course it's been an absolute tragedy for them. Mm-hmm. But the incredible thing was the support that all of his friends and family have had through the millions, literally millions of people around the world who'd grown to know and to love Comrade. And I think that support and that belief in him, you know, it's incredibly impressive. And it also has supported those who are closest to him, knowing what an incredible impact he had around the world in a relatively few years of being a global broadcaster.
Mm. Well, may he rest in peace.
Yeah, of course.
Now, let's start with you, man. You rose through the ranks. You started as a news trainee.
I did. I was a sort of a producer, you know, like the producers in this house, you know. So if you can kind of start as a producer, be a journalist, but then, you know, move on. And I've had great fun at the BBC all through my career.
Mm-hmm. Was it something that you always had in mind? I'm going to stick with the BBC all the way through, or you thought you were just starting off and then going to do
other things? I might go elsewhere, but they kept offering me, you know, more fun things to do, more interesting things. In the UK and then in the World Service now around the world, and I have a privileged role. I travel, I sort of can go pretty much where I want and see some incredible things and support the BBC teams around the world who are, you know, they're doing some great stuff. There's more than 250 million people every week who watch or listen or read our content, and all around the world people still have a huge respect for the BBC. Mm-hmm. Its reputation is still very high. Mm-hmm. Although, of course, the world has changed. I mean, you know, years ago in Ghana, there were, you know, relatively few stations. There was a state broadcaster. Yeah. There was maybe people listening to the BBC. Now, there's dozens of radio stations and television stations and television programs. So we have to work a lot harder to be successful. Mm-hmm. But that's good. It's because the world has changed. That's good to have more information. But we think it's still important that there's something, a source that people can turn to that they can really rely on. That's what we try to do.
Mm-hmm. And I see BBC has been going through some restructuring. Is it about keeping up with the competition?
We've had to make some savings, but we've also had to change because that shortwave listening in many parts of the world is no more. There are some places where it's still strong, so in parts of Nigeria, for instance, but other places, people aren't listening on shortwave in the same way. They listen on FM radio, they're listening on music stations, so our news is available there. And we've moved from radio into television, so you probably know Focus on Africa, our television programme, the second most interesting programme on Metro Television. A programme we've invented in the last couple of years, mm-hmm. Africa Business Report. So we're always inventing new things. We're about to launch a website for Africa, or our website will have a site, a homepage that is focused on Africa, where we'll be working with partner television and radio and online creators across Africa, really pulling together the whole story of Africa. So these are all new things that the BBC's started to do in recent years.
Speaking about the story of Africa, has BBC changed somewhat? Because I remember BBC used to have a lot of flack. I remember somebody writing an article and saying that Focus on Africa should be Focus on Crisis in Africa, because that's where all the focus was. But you're now doing business in Africa, you're doing other things.
Yeah.
Expanding to accommodate the other side of Africa? Is that the story?
Absolutely, absolutely. And I think there was a time when the BBC and other international news was too focused on negative things about Africa. Now, we won't shy away from difficult things about Africa. It's our job to hold those in power to account and to report things, which sometimes media organisations in Africa maybe are a bit scared to report, or is difficult for them politically or commercially. So that role is still really important. But politics and war isn't the whole of human life. It's not the whole of news. There's music, there's sport, there's cultural scene, there's fashion, there's all sorts of exciting things that are happening in Africa. And it is important that we reflect that properly. And I think we are starting to, much better than we used to.
Looking at the figures in terms of your viewers for TV and your listeners, are you keeping up? Is it rising?
Our audience is the biggest it's ever been. So more than 250 million people every week coming to the BBC around the world. And some of our audiences are going up, some are going down, but generally they're growing. And our audiences on television are growing fast in Africa, and the online audience is growing fast, and in particular social media. The BBC's Twitter information is the most retweeted in the world. So we beat New York Times, Huffington Post, CNN, because people trust what they get from the BBC. So that's a really important. I know, this show is watched by a lot of young people. I think that young people in particular, like sharing news. Here's something that's really interesting. There's a story about science. There's a story about health. There's a story about business. And you want to tell your friends about it. But you want to share some news that you can trust. You don't want to be telling your friends lie.
Yeah.
So if you want truthful news that you can share with your friends, the BBC is a great place to come.
Speaking of young people and attracting the young crowd, you're doing something on teenage now?
So in the UK, we've had a news service on our music station. We have a music station called Radio 1. And a few times a day, there's a 15-minute programme. And other times, top of the hour, there's a sort of two-minute summary. And we call that Newsbeat. So it's got news, but with music and a focus on stories that a younger audience like. So we've done that successfully in the UK for many years. So now the idea is we're going to be taking it around the world. We'll be doing it in the different languages that the BBC broadcasts in, in Hausa, in French, in Swahili, and so on. But we'll be doing it in English as well. So listen out for it. I hope you'll hear it on radio stations in Ghana before too long.
Okay. Show some love, man. Show some love. Let's get a bit personal at this point. You're married, I suppose?
I am, yes. I've got three kids.
Three kids,
growing up at university and beyond, yeah.
Yeah. How long have you been married?
Oh, more than 20 years. Yeah, 25 years, yeah.
That's cool. And all your children are there?
They are, yeah. They like Africa as well. They spend quite a lot of time here. My son's working in South Africa quite a lot at the moment. He's doing some political work down there with the elections that are coming up.
Also, he's in news.
He's a sort of political. He's a political guy. He sort of does polling and things like that. Anyway, he's working down there, down in South Africa. And my daughter spent a lot of time in Uganda, so she's very interested in Africa as well.
What are your hobbies?
I'm a great singer.
Well,
sorry. When I said I'm a great singer, I don't mean I'm a great singer. I mean, I like singing a lot. Is what I meant to say.
Oh, that's so cool. So,
and I play tennis.
Okay, you
and
still
ran,
play?
Ran a bit. Yeah, yeah. I still get about a little bit more slowly than I used to.
How often do you play?
I play every Sunday morning. Some guys I play with. Okay. But I do the singing twice a week. There's a BBC choir that I'm part of.
You sing in the choir.
I sing in a choir.
So what song can you do for us? The Ghanaian audience will be like,
You play something and I'll try and join in, but you know.
Really?
Listen to the BBC, you know, something. I don't know. Please play a track.
Give him a track, Bina. He will sing to it, man. Let's see some nice, interesting track. Let's hear the director of the BBC World Service singing.
I'm here in Ghana. I'm having a fine time. I'm talking to KSM all the time. And we're singing, because Ghana is fun. I love to be here. Thanks for having me on.
Just love it.
They don't put your show on YouTube, do they?
Yes, it
is. I don't want people in London seeing that or hearing that.
This particular segment will end up on YouTube.
Oh, dear.
Well, thank you so much for joining us, and it's so great to have you here. Thanks for singing for us.
It's been a pleasure.
Yeah, and maybe one day when I come to the UK, I'll also come to visit you, and don't tell me to sing, man. They will close the studios down.
We'll have you on one of our shows. We do have a music show. We have Africa Beats, so we'll have get you to join in with one of our bands as well.
No sweat, man. It's a deal.
Okay, so, thank you.
Thanks a lot, man. There we go.
I'm glad you didn't ask me to do the click. I found the clicks quite tricky.
Let's try it. Let's try. Is this and then?
Oh,
there
you go.
You did it. Just help, man. And stick around. We'll be back.
The KSM Show.
Well, folks, you know, it's been said that there's a difference between how the BBC sports commentators do their commentary and the local ones in Ghana. Well, I don't know too much about this, but Ziggity will show you. Ziggity Boggity!
Ghana, you're fake! Ghana, ya de, Ghana, aye see. Mechia, Ghana fo nyina ene enwiri, ene Ziggity Sports News. Ene de ye BBC day. Ye BBC day internet dem pese me ye bibi about BBC. Mo dem mo pamto mo hwe, mo dem mo ntia de ye mo hwe BBC fo mo, se na o ma commentary. Daniel Alves passes the ball to Messi, to Iniesta, Xavi, Neymar back to Daniel Alves. Back to Messi. Negredo get the ball. Passes to Yaya Toure. Oh, good ball from Yaya Toure. To Sami Nasri. Negredo. Oh, what is it by Vitor Valdes? No, Pacho. Me and Tim, me and Ghana for you. No, but it's in change here. When you're my one here, we're your phone, no crano. Never say. At your four. Phone, so let me crano. Where you? 66.6 FM. And I went so across 77.7 FM. And correct to a radio station. We are Krobia Asante Koroko on Kanakoto Kompo. Any Kumasi base King Fais and Edubono as a sesso. Krobia Asante Kotoko Playano. Okrabono. Abrantia Michael Kufu. Dudona Fernando Gaddafi. Okrabono Apasi. What do you mind if I say Jordan Opoku? Jordan Opoku Bede. What tobacco? What to me? What to me and Sansu? But you are not born baby Adano. And Juan aboni then call baby. What passi born with the Kokomasi Duansi. Said one Sibere, what trip back for Brentin in Borobo? A Brentin in Borobo, Odiko, and you go! What a goal! What a brilliant shot! Oh! Bonasse! Wrong information. Because, Umiyahu, King Fessa plays when you're with you. You're set 37 in Ajibono. What passes the command was 16. No, this was 16, the man was 18. You're ready to hear what I'm saying. I don't know what I'm going to say. Oh, home commentator. who support to Asante Kotoko, and I say we're a commentator.
Me pamacho, I'm Saka Ofo. Me pamacho, mumpani for muncho lete. Na mumfangon koma Madrid for ni se nyan dia Santiago Bernabeu on mubeba. Ne fi mponi na abonte. Me number ne dasi yano. Uko YouTube na bo zigi this sports news wa. Uwe hundi biya, uwe yana watch the watching. Ebe a mi di ejamu na wepi mi se. Aku kobi diye. Wouldn't add it here, and so you would see a free wouldn't you? I know. Now, what you send it? What's in car? Bye.
I'm Nana Nsakwa. With all the powers vested in me from Akwemu Edumasa, I put the royal seal of approval on the KSM show.
Hello, my name is Juliet Asante. I'm the CEO of Eagle Productions. I'm also the innovator of Mobile Flakes. Whenever I'm in Ghana, I make sure I watch the KSM show. I've been on many shows, but I can tell you this. This one stands out.
Beautiful. Shout out to love, man. All right. Well, you know, only on the KSM show, we have the whole director of the World Service, BBC, singing. Show some love, man. Coming up next, I thought today we are just hanging out with the BBC crew, man, the BBC posse. Coming up next is a lady, very, very hardworking lady. I'm so proud of her. We used to work together in radio. Well, not that way. She's not my co-equal. She was a much... She was my baby. She was my baby. Yes, and she's now actually the current affairs editor for Africa. Put your hands together. Show some love for Vera Kwakofi. Show some love one more time, man. Vera. Well, well done. That's all I can say. Well done, man.
You're part of the story.
Well. No matter what, you did it. You moved things.
Thank you very much. I'm really proud to be flying the flag of Ghana very high. And,
yeah.
Yes, and we thank God also for taking us this far. Yes.
Yeah. And we also, you know, part of the story that's missing is our great brother, Komla. You know, and being that you are coming from the BBC, just a word or two before. We do the interview. Your thoughts?
Yes, it's still quite surreal. I think that's the word I'd use, to know that Komla is no longer a part of our lives physically, but he'll always be in our hearts. Komla was an amazing brother, an amazing inspiration. Anytime I achieved anything at the BBC, I think he probably celebrated my successes more than I did myself.
You know,
I'd get emails from people saying, I spoke to Komla today and he's told me this about you and I'm so very proud of you. And it was just amazing. He's been like a rock. And I think even in death, he's still going to be a rock and an inspiration for all of us. Yes.
That's right. And I always say that we will remember him. Not for how he died, but for how he lived.
Absolutely.
And it was a fantastic life.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Great. Now to Vera. Man, you've just risen. How's life been? Now, remember the last time you came here, we started talking about some of the things that you do differently
there,
and you're talking about the detail.
Yes.
Taking some lessons and, remember?
I remember I'd come after hostile environment training, which is mandatory for BBC staff, because part of what we do at the BBC is going to really dangerous areas to report the news. But as a responsible employer, the BBC also ensures that you are protected and you're given the information that allows you to act as a journalist responsibly. So I just come back from hostile environment training, which is part of our training, and I've done a few since then.
Wow! And I remember you telling me about how you can even identify different gunshots by their sound. You still do?
The latest fire. I think your training last year, I think 3 years or so. So by the end of that period, you'd have forgotten what an AK-47
sounds like.
And we're trying to remind you of it again.
Wow.
But it's brilliant, absolutely.
So what do you think about the level of journalism, where they train you for
for war and scarier stuff, scary things like that.
Well, Kesam, you realize it's a very different world that we live in now. And, you know, the phrase, the war on terror, and the terror threats are more ever present in our lives. I mean, who would have thought that on Christmas Day, I think it was, 2010, the underpants bomber, Abdul Muttalab, came from Nigeria, you know, a neighbor to us. And he tried to bomb a plane in over America on Christmas Day. So it's no longer an issue that's far away, because when we were growing up, terror and dangers were very far away. Look at the crisis that happened in Mali. Soldiers went on mutiny. Next thing you know, they've been overrun by Al-Qaeda and Islamist militants. The country was in the middle of a religious war for a long time. Lots of people lost their lives. It's still in a fragile state. So, and Mali is what? Next door to us. So those sort of threats, Boko Haram in Nigeria, they're very close to us, and our West Africa borders are very poor. So it's time, I think, important for us to be interested in Ghana. We say that Ghana is a country of peace, and we like to mind our own business you know, try to be friendly to other people. But we have to be aware of the environment we're living in now, and be, and as journalists, be inquiring about how things like our foreign policy initiatives, how our employment policies, whether they affect the youth. We've got lots of young people in the streets of Accra, and that's one of the most heartbreaking things for me, that you drive around Accra and you see able-bodied young men wandering the streets with not a lot of things to do. And they say the devil finds work for idle hands. So if you mix that with a lot of influence from the wrong places, you'll have a cocktail that you can't deal with. So the earlier we deal with it, and it's our work as journalists to inquire how policies are affecting people's lives, how policies are changing people's lives, how they're improving people's lives, and interrogating the people behind those policies to ensure that, you know, it's our job as the fourth estate of the realm to take hold the authorities to account. And I think that that's what we have to continue to do.
Show some love, man. Show some love. What has been the toughest assignment you remember?
Wow.
Is there any such thing? Like a really...
I think one of the most difficult that I sort of remember was I was in Johannesburg on a different assignment on a Saturday morning. And then in my hotel room, I switch on the television and then hear about gunshots at Westgate Mall in Nairobi late last year. And Westgate Mall is a place I know very well, because Nairobi is like a second home to me. My first ever duty trip for the BBC was to Kenya on my own, to northern Kenya, bordering South Sudan. So, and Westgate Mall, on my last trip there in September, one of our closest friends took me there to the art cafe where the shooting started. And I know the balcony where the shooting started, where the, you know, gunmen started firing. I sat there. So it was a very, very personal tragedy for me, knowing Nairobi very well, knowing where that attack happened, and knowing how it sort of changed the psyche of a lot of my friends in Kenya, and how, you know, it also allowed the BBC to use its local knowledge. We have brilliant reporters there, Anne Soy, who's Kenyan herself, who shopped at that mall, could talk to the world about, you know, what the mall meant to Kenya, what it symbolized, you know, for Kenya as a cosmopolitan country and Nairobi as a cosmopolitan world city, and what that attack, you know, what sort of blow it dealt to the people. You know, Komla was there reporting for the BBC, and it was some of our best reporting as Africans, telling the African story to the world, and I think the BBC excelled at that. And so for me, watching it from a distance, it made me proud that, you know, a long time ago it would have been a different type of BBC that would have been reporting that story. New face of Africa that the BBC was showcasing, that was telling that story, and telling that story with a sort of passion and in-depth knowledge that we wouldn't have had at any time. So I think for me that was really important.
Wow, lovely, lovely. So let's get personal now. You're in the UK. Still very, very pretty.
Do you see me, I'm going?
What's going down, man?
What's going down?
Who the man?
Who the man?
Yeah.
I'm still what's the word? Interviewing.
Interviewing? Have they said CVs?
Yes, CVs. So I'm looking.
Really?
I'm looking through the CVs.
Ghanaians, British, Jamaicans, where are the CVs from?
you know, my mom would say, okay, make sure you bring a Ghanaian home. But my dad, you know, he's
they wanted to bring a Ghanaian home.
My mom would like that. My dad would like, he's happy with anybody. So, yeah.
And you?
And me? I think it's somebody who's going to understand where I'm from and somebody who appreciates that and appreciates, you know, my ambitions and is somebody who's willing to help me grow.
So there's nobody there now?
Yes, and you're asking questions I don't want to answer.
I want to know. Oh, Kwesi will tell us.
As my daddy, you can do the final vetting then.
As your daddy?
You can do the final vetting.
Yeah,
so we can talk.
But I have to see the list before I do the final vetting.
So I'll show you the list.
You show me the list. Okay. I'm sure Kwesi can help us. Well, folks, coming up next, another son of my man. He was also in the trenches of Vibe back in the day. He's now a presenter for Africa Service. Put your hands together. Welcome, Kwesi Asa. Kwesi, I've never talked to you on. You didn't do TGIF.
I did.
You did?
Once a long time ago.
Yes.
We had a long chat about time management, keeping to time, and all that. Yeah, some years ago. So I have been on. Thank God it's Friday.
You have? Okay. Well, welcome
Daddy,
to the case.
How come you don't remember?
Well. It's called age. You know, you gotta give me that. I earned this right to forget.
Yes. You have a right to.
Yeah, it wasn't easy, man. Good to see you, man. Good to see you. But I mean, you're doing so well, man. Both
Thank
of you,
you
man.
Thank
Show
you.
Them some love, man. Show them some love.
Well, like Vera said to you earlier, we took a lot of inspiration from people like you. You remember your days at Vibe FM, talk shop?
Yeah.
All those 2 hours on your feet, talking to this nation, you didn't go to waste. You inspired us. You know, we have the seeds that you planted. Thank you very much.
It's very, very good to know. Yeah, but, you know, because our dear brother passed not too long ago,
Certainly. We
always say, we ask our BBC posse to say something before we even begin, your thoughts?
Yes, my big brother, my friend, my posse, my main man. We've lost a Joe. We've lost an amazing guy talking about Komla in these terms. Haven't passed on. It's very difficult for me. But look, Komla was, he broke glass ceilings. He opened doors. He took us along with him, not just me, not just Vera. You know, every young person he met, whether it was in Ghana, whether it was in Nairobi, it was in Kenya, South Africa, he was that kind of guy, like Peter Horrocks said to you before, was that kind of guy that could have an easy conversation with the head of state and in the middle of the street, stop and talk to the street cleaner, and you think he had known him forever. Yeah. He was such an amazing guy, and he didn't do it because he wanted a story out of you. He did it because he cared about you. He was about humanity. And it's no wonder that it's not just people who are close to him who feel this great sense of loss. Even people who just heard him over the radio.
Yeah.
Back at work in London. Yes, of course, when you lose a dear colleague, you will mourn. But the sense of loss that people have felt when I've spoken to my colleagues, people will talk about that bear hug. Komla hugs you and he lifts you off your feet. When he shakes your hand, is a strong grip, and everybody feels that they have lost a personal friend. Such an incredible guy, and he will be a part of us for a very long time. He will be a part of us for a very long time.
He will.
Yes,
he will.
Certainly. Will. That dream, the values that he shared will continue to live on, and will show in the way we do our work, the diligence, the excellence, accountability.
That's great.
All those values that he stood for
will
continue to live with us.
And, show some love, man. And really, I think the greatest tribute we can pay to him is to have his work now in us, you know, young
Certainly.
Ones like you,
Certainly.
Take over the mantle and run with it.
Certainly.
And that's the greatest tribute you can pay with
it. You couldn't say it any better, KSM, indeed.
Show some love, man. Show some love. Now, putting the focus on you,
now.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes, we're the presenter. What's the transition? How has the transition been like?
Chief, you know the story now.
Well.
Okay, so. it was you and you and Anne Sechi, who was general manager at Vibe FM, and Kojo Mensah was the presenter of the breakfast show, the big breakfast show at the time, who gave me a chance. First of all, as a librarian. And then one day I got a call from Vera and Sechi, who said, look, gentlemen, we've been told you're interested in becoming a journalist. How about, you know, doing some attachment with the newsroom? So that is how it started. That sort of gave me the hands-on experience that I needed. I'll basically shuttle between lectures and come back and help Vera and the team in reporting and producing the Big Breakfast Show. And evolved from there. And then eventually I graduated from journalism school and, jumped ship. Michael Cook, chief executive Vibe FM then. Forgive me.
You defected.
Yes, yeah, because there was some rivalry, wasn't there, between Vibe FM and Joy FM at the time.
Yeah.
Samuel Atamensa was station manager. He played a role in my transition to Joy FM. He now manages CTFM, doing an incredibly great job there as well.
Yeah.
And I remember 2nd of April 2001, doing the 8 p.m. news, five-minute bulletin as soon as I was done. The first person to call me and welcome me to the team in multimedia was Komola Dumo, and basically took me under his wings, counseling, teaching, interviewing, coaching, and I was presidential correspondent. So between him and I, in terms of content for the morning show, when we needed answers from the presidency, and I'm talking about the presidency of former head of state, President John Ajikum Kufuor, when we needed answers to critical questions. And because I was presidential correspondent, Komola and I would sit with Stan Dogbe, who was executive producer then, and we'll think out what the issues were and how we had to ask them. And I'll go to the castle on a regular assignment, scheduled assignment, and yet I went there with specific questions in mind that had been researched and well thought out where we're going to ask it. And as soon as the official assignment and speeches were over, I will basically doorstep the president and shove the microphone into his face. I was instigated by Komola. Mr. President, now you know. And I'll throw the question to him. And he was always, you know, I think Mr. Kufuor actually looked through the crowd for me sometimes.
Yeah.
Because he knew, because he would listen to the radio.
Yeah.
And he was aware of some of these issues raging on, especially on the Super Morning Show on Joy FM, and he wanted to speak to them, but he couldn't come to the studio, so he would look out for me, and he knew I would definitely fire that question, and he would answer me, and I'll take it back, and it will form part of the content for Komola, and we'll build on the story from there, and bring in all the relevant players, and so that's how it was, and Komola, you know, felt at some point I would make a good, you know, co-presenter for the morning show, so he started, you know, grooming.
How did you get to the World Service?
They needed a producer for Network Africa. The role was advertised. I put in an application for it, and I was successful. And
so they called you for an interview?
Yes, I went for an interview here in Accra. Joseph Warungu, former current affairs editor for Africa, I emerged the chosen one.
When did they call you? How did you hear?
After the interview, they went back to London, and it was just before the 2008 election. Warungu, Joseph Warungu, calls me. I get a call from London. He says, Akwesi, I'm delighted to tell you were successful. I need you to pack your bags and come to London. And I said, Chief, I'm sorry. I cannot just move like that. There's an election coming up. I began to give excuses. And I'm playing a central role in the coverage. Indeed, I was. I wasn't fibbing. Yeah. So I can't just pack my bags and go, there's one more assignment I need to execute. Yeah. So you need to give me some time. I said, but I knew you like yesterday. I explained the situation to you. And I said, well, Chief, but this is the situation as well. I can't burn my bridges.
Yeah.
First with my organization that I'm working with. Mm. And also there's an election and I want to, you know, report on it. Country first. So he said, okay, do what you've got to do. So, you know, we did what you had to do on that in that election reporting period. And then in February 2009, I got a flight to London.
Wow. But that was a very interesting thing, you know. The average Ghanaian would have said, well, election, sorry.
Well, yes.
I'm going to the BBC. So I'm glad you stuck by it. It showed character.
And it's something that runs through Vera, through, you know, yeah, me, Komla, and indeed my colleagues in BBC, yeah, Africa. I mean, the reason why we do what we do is because we love our individual countries. Yeah. We are committed to what we do. We are committed to our people. It's the reason why we ask the questions that we do. Mm-hmm. It's the reason why we hold authority to account. It's the reason why we get angry when things are not working the way they ought to be, because, mm-hmm, you know, there's so much potential on the continent, mm-hmm, and yet things aren't just.
Well, congratulations to you both, man. Fascinating stories. Really fascinating. So how you guys hang out a lot in the UK?
We do.
Yes.
You do?
We've got our favorite eatery.
Yeah.
805 Old Kent Road. Good.
Yes. So Akwesi will order the fish, uh-huh, and then I will order pounded yam and okra soup.
Goat pepper soup.
And then we'll sit there and then just sort of...
It's an African restaurant?
It's a Nigerian. It's owned by a Nigerian, yeah, and Ghanaian, yeah. So we do that quite often. Yeah.
We'll have lunch or dinner and just have a conversation about our country and the continent, and sort of also come up with all sorts of ideas of news value. Mm. And some of these ideas almost invariably, you know, feed into our editorial meetings, back into the office. So, yes, we hung out a lot.
And Komla was a key part. We used to, we'd always sort of hang out in a corner of the building, and they'd see me, Komla, and Akwesi together and go, what are you Ghanaians plotting? What are you Ghanaians plotting?
Or occasionally they would just see us, and, you know, because the program is focused on Africa, and they say, yeah, that is focused on Ghana.
I asked Vera, I went personal with Vera, but you are, yeah, yeah. And I know her, very pretty.
Yeah, she put a ringer on it.
She's
amazing woman, my wife. She works here.
Yeah.
She works in regulatory and government affairs as a senior manager for MTN.
Yeah.
And she is, you know, a very career-focused, oriented woman. And there was no point uprooting her from something she truly enjoys.
So how are you doing the long distance thing?
Look, we've been doing this since, I think, 2004. And look, new media has been amazing. So look, we've done it. We've done Skype, we've done Twitter, we've done Facebook, we've done emails, we've done pictures. We are always looking for new technologies to leverage to our advantage. And then, of course, when holidays are available as well, I'll come home and she would come to London. And then I also look forward to trips that allow me to, you know, to
come,
you know,
this come, way. Come any through, kids?
Not as yet. It's work in progress. Yes, yeah. But it's fantastic. It's been an amazing journey fantastic. Since 2009 when we got married.
And, fantastic. You know. And I hear you have a very amazing way of introducing programs. This is something that the producer told me. Said, ask him. He has an amazing way of introducing programs. Let him do something.
I think it's just my sign in, really.
Your sign in,
which is basically, it's 1500 GMT. This is Focus on Africa from the BBC World Service. I'm Akwesi Sapong. I think.
Well, Akwesi and Vera, congratulations, man. I mean, for holding high our flag and keeping it flying higher. And I know you guys will be back here again.
Yeah. Certainly.
I may still be here.
Yes, you will.
I may still be here,
but
it will be very difficult to ask questions then, because I was 90. But no, on a serious tip, well done, man. You guys do us proud, man.
That way.
All right.
He's the funkiest daddy ever.
My two children, man. These are my kids, man. Thank you so much, folks.
Thank you very much.
We'll hang out with the BBC. Stick around, folks. There's more to come. We'll be right back.
The KSM Show.
Hello, I'm Irene Logan. It's the KSM Show. I'm enjoying it, so come join me.
All right, what up? My name is Sarkodie, a.k.a. you know what time it is, a.k.a. money no be problem, a.k.a. what else, a.k.a. now, a.k.a. what? You're watching my favorite show, the KSM Show. Keep it locked. Now!
And the eternal question on the lips of my next man, why?
Good evening, everybody, and welcome once again. This is Uncle Obama, and I am Dino, and welcome to Why? My first story for this week, Ghanaians, why again? You know, they started Winter Olympics and you didn't send anybody there. Bobsleighing, skating, nothing. Why are we afraid of the cold? Well, we have only one guy there. His name is Kwame Nkrumah. Hopefully he'll get medal or he'll get Indomie as usual. When we go to tournaments, we want wooden medal and Indomie. So big ups to Kwame Nkrumah. Go and skate, okay? Yeah. My second story for today. Oh, these girls. Why? You know, when you are going to steal, don't steal small things like pewter. The whole mall, you couldn't see anything apart from, there's plasma screen, there's food. You couldn't steal that, you stole drawers. You couldn't go to Kantamatu to do that. Oh, people. Why? Anyway, I hear that they are suing Mr. Price for whatever. Go and steal at Nima Market and say you will sue them. That is if you are alive. You see your Madam, why did you cut it? I said they will see their Fine, if you won't let me say it. My name is Dimitri. Uncle Obama agrees that they will see their that part. But if you have any question, you know what to do. Send it to this Twitter account and at Ahwai. I'm Dimitri, Uncle Obama, and this has been I can't wear it, but why?
Okay, once again, we have come to the end of another very, very, very exciting show. I'd like to say a big thank you to all my guests. Give it up for the BBC Posse one more time. All right. And I'd like to thank you, the viewers out there, because you people have made this show numero uno. So until I come back next week, KSM signing off saying, I am out of, let the whole world say.
But I know you'll be late, like you always do. And this time I promise to tell you how much I care, and to hold you close, 'cause you mean everything to me, dear. I could feel the